My name is Will Ford, and it is an honor to be with y'all here today. I want to share a word with you. I feel like it's from the Lord. So I was here a few months ago with my friend Matlock. How many of y'all were here for that? Yeah, powerful time. But I feel like today is an equipping day, because I feel like the supernatural is about to go to a whole nother level in this church. It's already starting, the water's already starting to rise. I was wondering, like, God, do I release this kind of word here in this church today? I've been praying about this for months. And after I hear about, you know, some of the testimonies that Pastor Michelle told me about, I was like, okay, I know this is the right message for right now. So turn with me in your Bibles. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Starting at verse 4. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. And look at verses 8 through 11. It says this: for to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge. The word utterance there is word of knowledge, according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, ability to distinguish between spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions each one individually as he wills. All right? Now, jump back and go off into Old Testament. This is Genesis 45, verses 26 through 28. It says this: then the sons of Israel did so, and Joseph gave them wagons according to the command of Pharaoh, and gave them provisions for the journey. To each of them he gave changes of garments, but to Benjamin he gave 300 pieces of silver and 5 changes of garments. To his father he sent as follows: 10 donkeys loaded with the best things of Egypt, and 10 female donkeys loaded with grain and bread and sustenance for his father on the journey. And told him, saying, Joseph is yet alive. His sons told him, Joseph is yet alive. He is governor of the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart fainted, for he believed them not. And they told him all the words of Joseph which he had told them. And when he saw the wagons which Joseph sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob their father revived. And Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is yet alive. I will go and see him before I die. How many of you know there are so many people need to see hope that God is still alive and wants to move in their midst? We need to know that the Son of God is alive and in their midst. And I believe that's how God is about to use Hope Christian. I believe prophetic ministry is about to go to a whole nother level in this church. And I want to talk about one particular aspect of that with word of knowledge. You probably have heard people teaching this before. I've been the Bible teacher in this area for about 20 years, but honestly, until like the past couple of months, I hadn't seen word of knowledge the way I've seen it, and I haven't seen it being applied in such a powerful way and being released wherever I go and preach this. So I want to release that in this house today. And it's not just for people to get words about a bad back, but also it's about so you can get words for broken systems. God is releasing dreams, he's releasing creativity in ways, in unprecedented ways right now, because, listen, he's using the church right now to be solutionaries, to becoming problem solvers to society. So that being said, can I pray for you? Jesus, we absolutely love you. God, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you praise, we magnify your holy name this morning. We thank you so much for forgiveness of sins. We thank you so much for newness of life. And Lord, we thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation being released in our midst. Holy Spirit, come and do what you do best and what you love most to do. Make us love Jesus more than before we came in here. We ask for words of wisdom, words of knowledge, and words of revelation for everybody who's here and who's watching online. We ask that your Holy Spirit would come in great power and great glory, release conviction of sin unto righteousness and salvation. But also, God, we ask you, release the prophetic in our midst, the testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy. We bind the devil and all his works. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen and amen. Well, one of my favorite scriptures, you ever see that scripture that says, the glory of God to conceal a matter? It's the glory of kings to find a thing out. I always wonder, what is that scripture about? What is God saying with that scripture? And it's kind of like, I call it the romance of the gospel. The romance of the gospel. The glory of God to conceal a matter, but the glory of kings to find a thing out. I remember, looking at kids doing the Easter egg hunts or whatever. How many of y'all remember that back in the day, the Easter egg hunts and all that? Right? And so before you got all cool and hip and understand the prophetic and understand the spiritual stuff behind that stuff, I mean, y'all know what I'm talking about. But you'd be a pretty bad father or grandfather if you put out the eggs for them to find them. And you decide, you know what? I'm going to make sure they're not going to find this one. So you dig a big old hole and you drop it off in there and put cement over it. And then you cover it and say, ha, they're not going to find that one. That's not a good father, right? That's not what the Easter egg hunt or whatever it is all about. It's about what? Helping the kids enjoy the journey of finding and discovering something, right? Right? I remember playing hide and seek with my dad back in the day. And, you know, I'd always find him because he always stick his big toe out, from under the curtain. I could find him, right? Sometimes he tricked me, put a shoe there, and I thought it was him. I pull it back, it's not there. But it was all about what? Enjoying the journey. That's how God is. Father God is the same way. It's all about enjoying the journey. I remember, there are times I take my wife on date night. I do date night with my wife. And sometimes I'll take her places and not tell her where we're going. She say, am I dressed right? Yeah, I told you what to wear. You're dressed right. And so we get there, and it'll be way better than she realized. So this last time I did it, I took her to this place. It's like one big wind tunnel, and it's the place where they simulate people jumping off planes, and right? So the place is one big wind tunnel. So you actually get in there, you actually fly around in this thing, right? And so I knew that if she knew where we were going, she would not get in there. She wouldn't put on the jumpsuit and the goggles. She wouldn't jump on that thing. So I made that one of our date nights. So I told her what to wear, and then we pulled up to the place. She said, Will Forther, there is no way I'm getting in that thing. I'm not getting in that machine. I'm not getting in that tube. I'm not going in that building. And, y'all, the whole time she's telling me this, and she's walking along with me. She takes my hand. She walks right into the building. I'm not going in that elevator. We get on the elevator, and we go up. I'm not putting on that jumpsuit. She puts the jumpsuits on. I'm not putting on those goggles. The goggles go on. I'm not getting in that tube and flying around. So you know what? I said, let me do it first. So I get in and I fly around a little bit. I thought I was going to do a whole lot better, to be honest. But but she saw me, and then she jumped in, and all of a sudden, I mean, she's all over the place. She's doing tricks with the guy and everything. You know, she took pictures and we put it all on social media and everything. And she loved it. You know why? It was my glory to conceal it. But it was her glory to find it out. That's what the gifts of the Spirit are for the church, y'all. It's the glory of God. It's the romance of the gospel. I believe that the best way to understand the romance of the gospel is to understand how God helps us step into enjoying life with him through taking some risks with him. And faith is spelled like this, R-I-S-K. Faith is spelled risk, so we have to take some risks. So I'm going to share with you some stories today based out of scripture and unpack this whole thing of word of knowledge in a way that helps you get it in a powerful way. My favorite Old Testament reference to the gifts of the Spirit, we read it right there in Genesis chapter 45, verses 26 through 28. Here's what it says. I'm going to read it again because it's just a powerful story. So what's going on in this story? So Joseph, his father, you know, basically thought he was dead. Y'all know the story. Joseph sold off into slavery by his brothers. So it's been like 22 years. The father all this time thought his son, Joseph, was dead. So the sons finally find Joseph. They go back to the father to tell him that Joseph is alive. And Joseph says, oh, you know what? I'm going to send gifts. I want all y'all to come to Egypt. Pharaoh said it's good for y'all to come live with us in Egypt. So he's going to send these gifts, but he sends special, specific gifts to his father to pick him up, to bring him back to Egypt. So Genesis 45:26 says, then the sons of Israel did so. So they leave, and Joseph gave them wagons according to the command of Pharaoh and gave them provisions for the journey. To each of them, he gave changes of garments. But to Benjamin, he gave 300 pieces of silver for the 5 changes of garments. To his father, listen, he sent as follows: 10 donkeys loaded with the best things of Egypt, and 10 female donkeys loaded with grain and bread and sustenance for his father on the journey. And told him, saying, Joseph, and they said to him, Joseph is yet alive, and he is governor of the land of Egypt. And listen, what happens? Jacob's heart fainted, for he believed them not. So he didn't believe him. Last thing he heard was they told him that, you know, his son was dead 22 years earlier. They told him what they said, but then they said, then it says this. And they told him all the words which Joseph said. Now that they're using their words, they're telling the words that Joseph said to him, which he said unto them. And when he saw the wagons, which Joseph said, in other words, when he saw the gifts that Joseph sent, look what it says next. The spirit of Jacob, their father, was revived. He says, it is enough. My son is yet alive. I will go and see him before I die. Isn't it interesting? When they said their words, that wasn't enough. But when they used the words of the son, all of a sudden, things began to click. And then when Jacob saw the gifts of his son, he knew that he was alive. Beloved, that's what I'm here to tell you right now. I believe right now God is releasing an anointing on this house for the gifts of the Spirit to be released in such a powerful way. Listen, because we can tell people all that we want to, but until we tell people the testimony of Jesus and tell them what Jesus told us to say to them, and then let them see the gifts, when they start seeing the gifts, they'll know, oh my God, the Son of God is alive and is operating right now in my midst. And their heart will become revived. I believe God is reviving the gifts of the Spirit in a way we never known before. And also expanding the way we think about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. All right? So there are different gifts of the Spirit. We saw them there in 1 Corinthians 12. There's a word of wisdom, which is supernatural application of God's word. There's a word of knowledge. That's the one we're going to camp on today. The supernatural ability to know and understand the mysteries of heaven and earth. Faith, the ability to believe God for the impossible. Healing, the journey of wholeness of a person's mind, body, or spirit to operate in the way God intended. Miracles, supernatural power. That's the manifestation of the impossible. Y'all been seeing that. I believe that's going to increase even more. Prophecy, the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to edify, warn, announce, or reveal the future, discerning between the spirits, the ability to know by the Spirit what a person is motivated, that person, whatever, the ability to know what spirit is in operation, in other words, tongues, the ability to pray the mysteries of God and strengthen the spirit of a man through a heavenly language, and then the interpretation of tongues, the supernatural ability to understand and receive revelation from a language you did not learn. So who are the gifts of the Spirit for? Everybody. As the young folks say, everybody, right? They're for everybody. What are the gifts of the Spirit? For the spiritual tools to advance God's kingdom territory and expand territory. Where are the spirit gifts of the Spirit from? They're from God. James 1:17 says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, right? And when were the gifts given? When Jesus gave them. And the why the gifts, and I just shared it with you. To me, one of the most powerful things is so that people can understand that God is in our midst and in Jesus is still alive and operating through the church. So Word of knowledge. So the word I want to spend time talking about today is word of knowledge, because this is the one I think is going to increase significantly in your church. Word of knowledge. So word of knowledge. As a good old red-blooded charismatic, we've always talked about, you know, the Greek word for word, and there are a couple of words for word in the Greek. One of them is rhema. How many of y'all love the rhema word, right? Rhema word, that's the word where it's the quickened word of God for a moment, the word that becomes flesh right in a situation, and it's like something quickens in you, you're like, oh my God, that's the word for right now, whatever, there's a quickening, right? We love the rhema word. We need the rhema word. But there's another word for word that is used here for word of knowledge. I thought that when it said word of knowledge, I thought it was the word for rhema, because it has to do with that revelatory word, that right now word. But that's not the word that's used here. It's the word logos. Say logos. Logos, not logos knowledge. What is logos? So we always have minimized logos to be just the written word, but logos, y'all, is so much more. You know why I know it's so much more? Because in John, when it says that Jesus was the word that became flesh, the word he uses there is not rhema, it's the word logos. So if Jesus is the logos, there must be something important about logos that we don't understand, that people in that time period, especially the Greeks, they understood. So logos is different from rhema. We often get cited by rhema because it means the inspired revelatory word from God for a given moment or situation, which is great. However, we've reduced the meaning of logos to simply the written word. But it's so much more. Logos for the Greeks was a principal way of understanding how the world unifies into an orderly cosmos. Nancy Piercy, here's what she says about the word logos. She said, despite the differences among them all, major civilizations have believed in a divine order that lays down the law for both natural and human realms that unify the world into an orderly cosmos, preventing randomness and chaos. For the Far East, it was called Tao. For ancient Egypt, it was called Ma'at. But the Greeks also had a term for the underlying principle that unifies the world into an orderly cosmos as opposed to randomness and chaos. They called it the Logos. The Logos. They felt like the Logos was a principle. Stoic philosophers conceived it as a bunch of multiple gods, the pantheon of the Greek gods, in their mind, pervading the universe. But the Apostle John applied the term to Christ. He said, in the beginning was the word, and that's the word is logos. Every Greek philosopher in that time period realized something we don't. John was referring to logos not as a principle, but to a person. Not as a concept, but as to Christ. John's gospel borrows the Greek word for this universal plan of creation, logos, and in a startling move, identifies it with a personal being, Jesus Christ himself. In other words, Jesus himself is the source of comprehensive plan or design of all creation. He's the building block for everything. Jesus Christ is the logos. He's the building block for all things, seen and unseen, because all things were created by him and for him and unto him. Every Greek who heard John's gospel understood that he was claiming that Christ himself is the source of the order and the coherence of all the universe. As Paul put it, in him, all things hold together. In Colossians 1:17, creation has a rational, intelligible order that reflects God's creative plan, and it's the Logos, Jesus Christ himself. So that's why the word logic comes from logos. So you want to make sense out of your chaotic world? Connect with the logos himself, and he'll release his logic. He'll release his divine logic and bring order out of chaos. So in the essence, logos is God's infinite eternal logic revealed in our finite space and time. So that's the word for word of knowledge. There's logos, which is powerful. But the word for knowledge there is gnosis, which just means to know. There's another word for knowing, which is more experiential and intimate. It's the word epignosko or epignosis. It means a clear and exact knowledge which expresses a more thorough participation in the object of knowledge on the part of the knowledgeable subject. In other words, there's this intimate knowing that you have because of your experience and your connection to someone else. But when you connect to God in that kind of epignosis way, he releases his gnosis into your situation and everything begins to change. So words of knowledge are God's inspired thoughts coming to a human mind, and they come in different ways to help us understand the mysteries in heaven and in earth. Now, sometimes some ways words of knowledge come. Sometimes it's just something you just know that you didn't know before. And a lot of times in the spiritual way these things happen, it's like with Jesus when he was getting baptized, and they said the dove came down, the Spirit, Holy Spirit came down like a dove and remained upon him. Right? Sometimes the Holy Spirit would just light upon you and you just know some things you didn't know before. Right? Sometimes you'll see a picture. How many of y'all see pictures or whatever? Just a picture come to mind and you'll see something. Sometimes you just hear a word and you know it's not you. Sometimes you can feel different things. Like sometimes I'll feel something like my elbow, hip, or whatever. And I know the Lord wants me to pray for somebody in the room that's dealing with it. That's how words of knowledge come. But it's interesting. Jesus saw the Holy Spirit come and descend like a dove. A dove coming and descending on your shoulder. Doves are very fickle. They don't just land anywhere. And they don't just stay anywhere. In other words, what if you were to live your life with the dove in mind? What if you were to live your life where you know you want the Holy Spirit to come and remain upon you? You would change the things you looked at, places where you went. It would reorient the way you think about a lot of different things because you want to, what, stay connected to, yeah, the Holy Spirit resting upon you, right? In other words, God wants to raise us some people who will walk around with a dove in mind. And that's what I believe he's doing here at Hope. God is raising up people who are going to walk around with a dove in mind, amen? All right, so many times people use words of knowledge for healing ministry. But words of knowledge are not just limited to just church buildings and prayer rooms. But it's also for kitchen tables and boardrooms. I'm going to tell you some of these stories that I've seen with word of knowledge. And after we share it, hopefully God give us some words of knowledge for people in the room today. Amen. So the first time I believe I ever got a word of knowledge, I was 16 years old, and I got it from my praying grandmother. My grandmother on my father's side of the family. And so I was at our house in Fort Worth, Texas, 16 years old, and she looked in the backyard. She said, come here, little Will. Look over in the backyard back there. She said, you see that pot sticking up out of the yard in the backyard? I said, what pot? She said, keep looking. It's the pot just sticking up out of the backyard. I said, I don't see it. She said, Pookie, that's my nickname. Boy, I know you see that blankety blank pot sticking up out of the blankety blank. My grandmother was kind of like Madea a little bit, all right? She'd quote scripture, but she'd cuss you out every now and then. Her dove had a problem staying every probably in there. But I look back there, and sure enough, I see this old pot. I said, what's the deal with that pot? And then all of a sudden, everything changed. The dove comes. And she's like, God's going to use you with that pot someday. I'm going to make sure before I die, that pot gets passed down to you. And y'all who were here a few months ago, y'all know the story. That's how I heard the story of the pot. That pot was passed down to me from my father because of what my grandmother prophesied over me. That pot was used by the slaves of my family. They used it for cooking. They used it for washing clothes. But secretly, they used it for prayer. And I started taking that pot around the country about 20 years ago, talking about how it was the prayers, not just black Christian slaves who are praying underneath kettle pots, but also white Christian abolitionists and revivalists, how those folks prayed into being the first and the second great awakening. Had it not been for those revivals, slavery would have never ended in our nation. I found out that story about that one pot was not just in my family. That That story was all around the country. I found it in 3,000 other slave narratives. I found 400 times where they talked about secret prayer meetings and how they had to use washpots and kettles to muffle their voices. So it led me on this amazing journey, sharing this story around the country. Then I had this dream with Dr. King in it, where God dealt with me my unforgiveness issues, and wound up sharing that dream and that story here with a guy who was led here because of a dream. He had a dream about a man who was putting together a prayer meeting named Lou Engle. He didn't know who he was, found it was a real person. He comes to that prayer meeting, and we meet January 17, 2005 at a prayer meeting at Hope Christian Church, where a conference was going on put on by a man named Lou Engle, and Bishop Jackson hosted it. And so me and that white guy, we met. We became friends. We've been friends for 18 years now. Well, fast forward, that white friend of mine, he found out that the Civil War ended in his family's front yard. So we thought, man, what a cool coincidence. I got this pot where slaves pray for freedom. You have this house where General Lee fought his last battle. We thought, what a cool coincidence. And then we stumbled on more research, and we realized it was his family who owned my family, where the kettle pot came from. And we met at the Lincoln Memorial on MLK Celebration Day. Then later at this church, both led by dreams to the place where Dr. King said, I have a dream that one day the sons of former slaves, sons of former slave owners, would sit together at the table of brotherhood. Because at a kitchen table when I was 16 years old, my grandmother gives me a word of knowledge. Amen. And I've been flying around the world with that pot ever since, because somebody gave me a word that changed my trajectory. Amen. I believe words of knowledge is going to come through this church that's going to change the trajectory of other people. All right, so I remember first time God started using me with this, I remember it was 2002. I was on an airplane, and this word of knowledge just comes over me. And I turned to the young lady next to him in the plane, and I said, you're from Southern California, right? She said, yes. I said, now L.A. was somewhere close. She said, well, I'm from Fresno, but now I live in Long Beach. I said, oh, so you go to Long Beach State, right? She said, yes. I said, you're a sophomore there? She said, yes. I said, you're a psychology major? She said, yeah, because it's getting kind of weird. I said, you have a friend named Tiffany? She said, I have two friends named Tiffany. What is going on? I said, I don't know. I usually don't do this unless there's music playing in the background. All I know is that God, he really loves you. Jesus has an incredible plan for your life. You know, I saw prophesying about an Esther anointing coming over her life. And this whole thing begins to lift, and the Lord says, William, ask her name and tell her there's something very precious about her name. Honestly, I said, okay, God, this has been so good. Why don't you just tell me her name? And the Lord said, no, stick with the script. Ask her name and tell her there's something precious about her name. I said, the Lord's telling me there's something precious about your name. What's your name? She said, my name is Zion. I said, Zion, did you know your name's in the Bible? I flipped over to Isaiah 62 and I started reading. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent till her name becomes a praise in the earth. And she said, this is crazy because I'm flying from California to Kansas City to be in my cousin's wedding. So really, now the Lord's telling me there's something precious about your last name. What's your last name? She said, Ready. I said, did you say ready like a wedding? What did you? She spelled it for me four times, R-E-D-I-E, but she pronounced it ready. And the Lord said to me, girl's name was Zion Ready. The Lord said to me, just as you prophesied an Esther anointing over her life, I betrothed myself to a fatherless Esther generation. And just as her major was psychology, I'm majoring in the heart and the soul of this next generation because there's a major battle going on for the soul of this nation. And I'm getting Zion ready for a wedding. And I'm marrying different races. I'm marrying different movements together. And the synergy of this agreement would break the power of the death culture over your nation. So that's the word I had. And I prophesied it over her. And so, but all because I'm sitting next to her on the plane, give her this word. Somebody heard me give this word years later, and so they actually went to Long Beach State to find her. And they did. They found her. She was working in the administration at that time. Everything I prophesied over came to pass. Great favor came to her. And that she said that word changed her life, all because I paid attention to the dove while I was on the airplane. Right? I'll share this other one with you. Luke 5:5, Jesus and Peter. Y'all know that story, right? He gets a word of knowledge from Mr. Logos himself, right? Simon's answering. Jesus says to him, you know, hey, cast your net on the other side. Y'all know that story? And Simon answered to him, Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. That word for word there in the Greek is rhema. It's rhema. It's interesting. It's the word rhema. Well, when Mr. Logos shows up, everything he says, what, is a rhema moment. And y'all know the story. He casts his net on the other side, and what happens? He pulls in this huge haul of fish, so many that he has to get the guys off the fishing bank who are on the other fishermen to come help him with this huge haul, right? Let me tell you, that actually happened for a young lady who's a student of mine. When I was teaching at Christ for the Nations, this actually happened to her father. He's an Alaska fisherman, and he has this 52-foot-long commercial fishing boat. He's fishing in Alaska. In that particular summer, it was already forecast that it was going to be a bad summer for fishing, and they were right. It was. And that particular day, nothing was biting. They were out there all day long. Nothing was happening. So while all the other boats were on the dock, and they were all watching movies, that's what they do. They say in the commercial fishing thing, and when the fish aren't biting, the guys are just on the bank and watching movies, looking at different films. But Mark Eaton decided to stay out and continue fishing. So he stays out and continues fishing. He's about to turn everything in, and he'd already reeled in his huge net. Those nets are like a mile wide. 12 fathoms deep. I don't know how deep that is, but that just sounds deep. Just to use the word fathom, making sounds deep, doesn't it? 12 fathoms deep. So he'd already reeled it in, but then he heard the Holy Spirit say, cast your net on the other side. And he was going to respond like Peter did, hey, I know fishing. You know Bible teaching. Nothing's, they got sonar equipment where they can look up under and see. Nothing's happening. So, but he's this word of knowledge is so strong on him. He tells his daughter and the guys working on the boat, let us let out the net again. So they let out the net and they see nothing's happening. And all of a sudden, fish start jumping on top of the water. And all of a sudden, the water begins to boil. And the nets begin to break. And he has to tell the guys on the side of the, who are, back at the bank, hey, y'all, Netflix and chill is done. I need y'all to help me with this big haul of fish. They caught over 256,000 pounds of salmon that day. So not only did he get blessed, but people on the banks got blessed. Listen, sometimes, like I say, with these things, when words are not, it's the glory of God to conceal a man, it's the glory of kings to find a thing out. Yeah, you got to take a risk. You're not going to get this thing perfect every single time, but if you can cross the bridge of nevertheless, if you can cross the bridge of nevertheless, listen, there's a huge haul of souls on the other side. There's a huge haul for your harvest on the other side. There's a new innovation for your business. There's a new strategy. There's a new breakthrough right on the other side of nevertheless. I need some nevertheless people at Hope, right? Nevertheless. All right. So people think of words of knowledge and they think, it's just for a church service. No, this is supposed to be part of our normal way of life, right? Y'all been on this amazing series on the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Literally, that's what we're supposed to be walking out in. From the classroom, to the boardroom, to the prayer room, every area of your life, you have access to wisdom and strategies from heaven. Let me give you one good example. If you put the first slide up for me, this man here, this is George Washington Carver. George Washington Carver, he saved agriculture in the South during the Dust Bowl era because of a word of knowledge about the peanut. Y'all probably know the story here because you love history like I do, but George Washington Carver said this. He said, when I was young, I said to God, God, tell me the mystery of the universe. But God answered, that knowledge is for me alone. So I said, God, tell me the mystery of the peanut. And God said to me, well, George, That's more nearly your size. And he told me. And most people say that was probably more anecdotal. But literally, George Washington Carver would go on fast for several days and would go into his laboratory with nothing but a Bible, a pen, and a notepad. And he would connect with God, and the Lord would give him downloads on different things. So here's what George Washington Carver said that God told him about the peanut. He said, separate the peanut into water, fats, oils, gums, resins, sugars, starches, and amino acids. Then recombine these under my three laws of compatibility, temperature and pressure. Then, the Lord said, then you will know why I made the peanut. Isn't that powerful? So what happens? During that time period, cotton was so depleting the soil that the Dust Bowl era, I mean, farmers were going bankrupt. People were losing money and because they couldn't grow anything because cotton so depleted the soil. But what George Washington Carver found out was that if you replenish the soil by planting peanuts, it actually puts nutrients back in the ground so you can start back, you know, planting the cotton harvest. So, but none of the farmers wanted to do that because they didn't see any ways that you could make money off the peanuts. So God gave George Washington Carver over 300 inventions for the peanuts. 300. He said this, as I worked on projects which fulfilled a human need, forces were working through me which amazed me. He said, I often go to sleep with an apparently insoluble problem, but when I awoke, the answer was right there. Why then should we who believe in Christ be so surprised at what God can do for those willing, for a willing man in a laboratory? This is what George Washington Carver said. Some things must be baffling to the critic who has never been born again. George Washington Carver said, I love to think of nature as an unlimited broadcasting station through which God speaks to us every hour if only we are willing to listen. Andy Andrews said this of George Washington Carver. He said, within 10 days, George Washington Carver had discovered more than 300 uses for the peanut. One trip to that special place in the woods to talk with God not only enhanced race relations at that time, but also fundamentally changed the agricultural industry as we know it today. All because he listened to and felt the Spirit of God in his life. And ever since then, shoo, taken off. So you can get words of knowledge in that way. But then also, too, another way I get words of knowledge a lot of times is through dreams. How many people are dreamers? Right, God, you give you a dream in the middle of the night. Job 33:14. For God speaks once, yea, twice, yet man perceives it not. In a dream, in a vision of the night, when deep sleep falls upon men and slumberings on the bed, then he opened the ears of men and he seals their instruction. So dreams are God's pillow talk, where the lover of our soul shares his divine thoughts with us. All right. So, there's this one time. Sometimes God uses me with like dream interpretation. And so, and that's another way you get words of knowledge. When you listen to somebody's dream, all of a sudden you just know exactly what it means. I was on the plane once. I don't know why God does this on planes so much with me, but I got these plane testimonies. And so I'm on the plane and I'm really tired. I just got 3 minutes and I didn't feel like talking to nobody. You ever do that? Right? I didn't have headphones with me, so I took the biggest, thickest book I could find to make it look like I'm going to be absorbed in this book. Don't bother me, whatever. But who sits next to me? Chatty Cathy, right? I hope there are no Cathys out here. This is not against you or whatever. But she's just chatty. And the Lord says, I want you to minister to her. Put your book down and listen for her passion. So I'm listening to this lady, and she's just yada, yada, yada. She's talking up a storm. And she starts talking about how she loves mountain climbing. Now she's into mountain climbing, and she said, "Matter of fact, that mountain down there, I've climbed it several times. There's actually this little ridge you go up, and there's a cleft in the rock." And she said, "I go off in there and actually sleep there, spend days there sleeping sometimes." I said, "Really?" And she was telling about how she was all off into the New Age and other stuff, and then she said, then I asked her, I said, "Hey, you know, when you go off in that cave, do you ever dream?" She said, "Yeah, I have the same reoccurring dream." I said, "Well, you know, I interpret dreams." New Ager, right? She's like, she's thinking I'm one of those New Age guys. She's, oh yeah, let me tell you this dream. People just need to have folks around them who can translate what God is doing in their life. Amen. They don't understand the language sometimes, so that God will put you next to them to help them understand what God is doing. Why didn't God give Joseph the dream? Why did he give Pharaoh the dream of the famine of 7 years and 7 years of plenty? Why did he give it to Pharaoh, not Joseph? But he puts Joseph in proximity to him. Why? Because God wanted Pharaoh to know that he's the kind of God that loves to make people's dreams come true. And if he can get one of us next to people like that, we can become the father to the pharaohs in our day. We can interpret dreams of kings and leaders. I can't tell you how many congressmen, senators, U.S. senators that come to me with dreams that they've had, and I got a chance to interpret the dreams for them. And God gives them divine strategy on handle this legislation or that thing that's going on in their life. You think those folks don't need prayer and somebody next to them that understands the prophetic? So I'm on the plane. She tells me a dream. In the dream, she says, I'm in this living room, and I feel all this peace when I'm in that living room. But for some reason, I walk away from all that love and peace that I feel, and I go down this dark hallway, and every door that I try to open in the dream is locked. I can't open them. But then I get to this one door. It's very dirty. I go inside. It's dark, and I feel so embarrassed about how dirty it is. I try to clean it up. But she says, but the more I try to clean it up, the dirtier I get and the dirtier the room gets and the dream ends. I said, really? I said, you know, I believe God has given me the interpretation for your dream. I said, that living room is the place you were meant to live. You were meant to live in God's presence. I said, you didn't tell me this, but I believe the Holy Spirit is telling me that when you were a teenager, around 15 to 16 years old, you gave your life to Jesus Christ, but you walked away. And that's what that hallway represents, is your walk of faith. It's been a very dark place. You walked away from the presence of the Lord. And God has protected you. You tried to open some doors, but God protected you by not allowing you to go through those doors. But right now, that's where you are right now in your life. You're in that last room. You're trying to clean up your life, but you can't do it without Jesus. So I shared that with her. And Before we landed on the flight, guess what? She accepts Christ in her heart while we're on the plane. And the Lord began to turn her life around. Why? Because I paid attention to the dove that rested on my shoulder. And I didn't go to sleep and ignore and put my face in a book. Let me share with you one other story. Put up this other slide. This is William Merrill Voorhees. William Merrill Voorhees, this man was a YWAM missionary. And he goes to Japan. While he's in Japan, he was an architect before, started the architect trade, but then he gets asked to help with, you know, some buildings that they were going to build in Japan. So the Lord tells him to start an architectural firm. He starts an architectural firm, hires people that he's, you know, leading and discipling to be part of that architectural firm. He's an amazing businessman in that regard, but he also listened to the Lord. So one day, the Lord gave him a dream. Back in, you know, Japan, not just those days, but now, they have a problem with earthquakes, right? Because of the way the island is set up, the way the nation is set up. Anyway, he has a dream one night, and in the dream, he sees all these little spaces that he can put in buildings and high-rises that if an earthquake happens, the building won't collapse like it always used to do back in those days. So he wakes up from the dream, he makes a patent for this thing, and they started building buildings in Japan with this earthquake-proof spacers that he put together. In other words, William Merrill Voorhees is the man who invented the earthquake-proof building. Yeah, and all because he got it what? Through a word of knowledge in a dream. Also, one time he was in a dream, and the Lord starts showing him just different ointments he could put together with different mints and herbs. And if you mix them together, it could be this vaporizing thing that you could put on your chest and in your nose. In other words, William Merrill Voorhees is the man who invented mentholatum. All because he got it through a word of knowledge and a dream. All right. That's him. And then let's look at this one. Man of C.J. Walker. All right. Some of y'all remember this story, Man of C.J. Walker. For those who don't know, Man of C.J. Walker, she was a sharecropper. Born in slavery, then right after slavery, she'd been married two times, and both men were cruel to her. After the second marriage failed, she decides to give her life to Jesus. Right, this This is the stuff you didn't see in the documentary that was on A&E or whatever. She gives her life to Jesus and her hair starts falling out. And she buys stuff to put on her hair and her hair starts falling out even more. So she prays. She said, God, I need you to help me with my hair. And that night she has a dream. In the dream, the Lord shows her roots and berries she can put on her hair to help her hair to grow back. And so she orders off for those things. She mixes it together and she puts it on her hair and her hair starts growing back faster than it was falling out. She did the same thing for her friends who was having the same problem, and their hair started growing back faster than it was falling out. So she started Madam C.J. Walker Miracle Hair Grow Company. And Madam C.J. Walker became the first woman millionaire in America, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, because she paid attention to a word of knowledge that she got in a dream. Right? Give you another good example of this. A spiritual son of mine, like I have one spiritual son, Draper Smith. My ceiling is his floor on this stuff, right? I mean, he gets a word of knowledge every now and then for, I know, right? He'll get a word of knowledge sometimes for different things. I've seen him get Social Security numbers, stuff like that. I mean, he's just next level with this stuff. So I was telling him about this message I was preparing on word of knowledge, and I was seeing how word of knowledge just not applied toward, you know, prophetic ministry as we know it, but also inventions, creativity, and other things. He said, yeah, that just started happening to me, Will. He said, I had a dream the other night, and the Lord starts showing me these ice cubes, and then he starts teaching me how to draw the ice cubes in his dream. He said, and I woke up from the dream. All of a sudden, I knew how to paint. I knew how to do art. He said, and I actually painted and drew this picture. I saw the picture and I was dumbfounded. So if you don't mind, put up that picture. This is the picture that Draper drew. That's not a snapshot. That's what he woke up and drew after he had the dream. I believe God wants to deposit in people this level of creativity, this level of innovation through words of knowledge. That makes sense. Stand to your feet. I want to pray for you. Like I said, I feel like today is a day of time of equipping. So here's some takeaways when it comes to gifts of the Spirit. People don't care how much you know till they know how much you care. Right? All the corporations have been saying that in customer service, but it's true. People don't care how much you know till they know how much you care. Knowledge puffs up, but love edifies, and love never fails. Love is the motive, not knowledge. And you only have authority over that which you love. Words of knowledge tell someone that they are known by the God who loves them. Words of knowledge give people faith for life. Words of knowledge and prophetic ministry grow and develop by our intimacy with God and our spending time in the Bible, all right? And God wants you to know he loves you. And he's alive and wants to be involved in your life. Reveal the gifts to others and watch God revive those around you. Because once they see the gifts, they know that the giver is alive. Amen. Pastor Michelle, you come up. We just want to wait on the Lord a little bit. I want to pray for people in the room. But the first thing is this. I feel like there's some people here, maybe that you're watching on TV or whatever, and you've been having just a block in this area. It's like been a ceiling over you. Wanting to hear from the Lord, different situations or whatever. But you know it's because of willful sin and disobedience, but you won't let that thing go. God is saying, if you let it go today, there's something on the other side of you nevertheless. You'll take off in ways you've never known before. I don't know what that thing is that's blocking it, and you know what it is that's blocking it. But if you know that's you, just raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Whatever that block is, thank you, Lord. 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 Just place your hand over your heart right now. Father, I thank you for those who've openly confessed right now, Lord. Whatever that block looks like, whether it's unforgiveness, whether it's bitterness, willful sin, disobedience, Lord, I just come in agreement with them right now. Lord, we lay those things down right now. Everything that hinders love, everything that hinders the free flow of your spirit connecting with us, God, we want the dove to remain on us. God, I thank you for those even right now who confess that right now. And I ask Holy Spirit, come right now. Just rest upon them right now. Let them feel you like a blanket. Rest upon them in the name of Jesus. And I bind everything that hinders love right now in the name of Jesus, whether it's every blocking spirit, every soul tie right now in the name of Jesus, as binding mind, will, and emotions, I break the power of it right now in the name of Jesus. And I thank you for clarity, and I thank you for them being able to hear your voice clearly in the name of Jesus. Pastor Michelle.
There's a lady right here in this pink lavender, I think it's a dress. You right here, you have a mask on? Yeah. Lift your hands to the Lord. The Lord was just beginning to minister to me that his hand is upon you in this season. And you're about to step into a new season. You've been searching and you've been inquiring of the Lord. And he wants you to know today that he's heard your cry and your prayer. And that today is a day of impartation and activation for you. And you're going to begin to go in seasons of preparation here and there. And God has raised you up for a specific day and time. But that time is not yet. Mm-hmm. And so you just don't want to cast off your confidence or your trust in God because you haven't seen those things yet come to pass. But know, like Esther, you're a signpost of the glory of God to other women. And so you've always stood out. You've always been different. And that difference has made you feel at times insecure and at times challenged. But God says today, I'm rolling away the shame and I'm breaking you into this new season because now it's the time to prepare for that place of reigning. So, Lord, we just thank you for your daughter. We thank you for this word of wisdom. We thank you for this word of knowledge for her life. God, I thank you that she will not cast off her confidence, that she will not be weary in well-doing. We release the strength of God, the wisdom of God, the anointing of God upon her life to wait for the appointed time of release. And, God, I thank you for what you're doing right now in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. And certainly, about mid-row down in the red shirt. Raise your hand for me. Yes, sir. I feel like that word that Pastor Michelle gave earlier about it's time to go on the offensive. I feel like that's you right now. You've had some offensive things actually done to you. But this is the season where you go on the offense. And I heard these words over you. Pursue, overtake, and recover all. Everything the enemy has stolen from you. Some of them spiritually, but some of them some literal things that the enemy has taken from you. And this is a season for you to stand your ground and reclaim what the enemy has stolen. Is this making sense to you? So if you put your hands up in receiver mode, I just want to pray over you. Father, right now, I thank you for this amazing man of God. I thank you for, Lord, the decisions that he's made the past few months, Lord, to turn his heart to you. And everything that the enemy has stolen, God, we thank you for the turn of the divine turnaround happening in his life. I thank you, Lord, for him going on the offensive in this season and things not just happening and not just falling apart. But I thank you, Lord, that he takes authority and use the authority you've given him, reclaim everything that's been lost, everything that's been stolen, and we call it back. In the name of Jesus, thank you for the season of restoration that he is stepping into right now. In the name of Jesus. Come on, give the Lord a clap.
Amen. 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 Brother Reuben, I have a word for you, but I believe this is a word for a lot of the men here in our church. And I just saw it when we were in the worship, that the Lord's hand is upon you, and you've seen your wife's walk, and you've seen her desperation for God. But the Lord's saying that even as you break that alabaster box, that even as you come from that place of desire that's deep inside of you in worship, the Lord says he's going to break you into new realms of provision. That in this season, your provision is linked to your worship. And the Lord says that he wants to exceed your expectation in this time. That he wants to break limitations off of your life. And the way through is through worship. So just lift your hands in the presence of the Lord. Father, I thank you for my brother. I thank you, Lord, for his life. And I thank you for that new cry in worship. Hey. And I thank you for the release of the Spirit that's coming upon him, but also upon the men of this house, God. I thank you that you're breaking the limitations of what society has said and what family has said and what people have said. God, you're raising them up in this time for your glory in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name. Every person in the marketplace leaders, business leaders, raise your hand. You teach or work in corporate America, have your own business. I feel like those are the ones. Father, right now, for these right now, I thank you for uncanny, ridiculous favor.
Yes.
I thank you for over their life, Lord, promotion, but not just promotion. Lord, I thank you for making them solutionaries in the marketplace, in the name of Jesus. I thank you for words of wisdom, words of knowledge coming down, divine strategies from heaven being released over them right now, Lord, to make them problem solvers and just the people around them, Lord, would see that they're just this. There's something different about their spirit. I think that the influence that is on them in this hour be used by you to impact people to come into your kingdom, but also, Lord, to help them figure out horrible situation. God, release your divine logos, your divine logic into chaotic situations. And God, make them problem solvers to society right now in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for the financial resources that are going to follow as well. But I thank you, Lord, for even witty adventures coming in some of you right now in the name of Jesus. The next new thing on the iPhone app has not been invented, right? The latest and greatest. No, God has given some of you divine wisdom and strategies. There's somebody in here who's a software engineer. Software engineer. Yes, Lord, I thank you, Lord, over this software engineer. Others like him. Lord, I thank you for your science, your logic, your logos being released. Witty inventions being released in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
So this was a time of impartation activation. So let's just seal this in the spirit because you've received more than you think. So let's just begin if you have a prayer language, just begin to pray in the spirit. We're just going to pray in the spirit for about 2 minutes. If you are not filled with the Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, you can just begin to thank the Lord for the revelation today. Thank you, Lord, for opening our understanding to know the word of knowledge. Father, we thank you that you're positioning us for such a time as this, God. You're raising up Josephs. You're raising up Esthers. You're raising up Deborahs. You're raising up Daniels. God, you're calling us as your church into the offices of government, into places of influence, and you're calling us to be your voice. So Lord, we thank you that today we step into this new grace. We step into this new dimension. We step into this new anointing. We step into this new authority. We step into this new grace. We take up the mantle of the Lord. Hallelujah. And we say that the mountain of the Lord will be established at the top of the mountain in this season. And we thank you, Lord, that we will come into this new season of restoration, of recovery. Oh God, we thank you for your word this morning. Just keep plowing in the spirit. Come on, a little bit more. Yes, come on, a little bit more. Se kalaba she keke ki ama kolobose ikana makoloboska hatarabaseya hotoroboska. God, we thank you that you're calling your ecclesia to arise. Oh God, we thank you that the wind of the Spirit is blowing upon your church in a fresh and a new way. And Father, we thank you for revelation, eyes to see, ears to hear what thus saith the Lord, and we'll be faithful to the call. We'll be faithful to the assignment. We're available. You can send us out and into the new place and the new ways that you've called your church to serve. God, we thank you that you've chosen and you've selected us for such a time as this. Come on, give him praise right now. Give him glory right now. Hey, hallelujah, hallelujah. Want to thank you. It's always fun to flow with your friends and minister. So this is the official end of our service, but I want to encourage you, if you can stay over for 11:30, stay over. Get a double dose, get a double dip, all right? If you want to sow into Will's ministry, you can do that. Our offering baskets are available on your way out. If you were here for the very first time, please avail yourself. Get your guest gift. We would love to see you again. Let me bless you, Father. We thank you. Cause your face to shine upon them and give them peace henceforth and forevermore, opening uncommon doors of favor and increasing them in every way according to your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Our bookstore is open. Have an overcoming week. We love you.